Over to you, Ashutosh.
Okay, great. So welcome everyone in yet another chapter of our webinar series, Let's Talk Genomics with Experts. Today we will be hearing about pre-pregnancy and prenatal genetic screening from a domain expert. As you know, pregnancy is a time of great anticipation and sometimes anxiety. There might be worries about fetal health and any underlying genetic defects. While most babies are born genetically normal, it's important to understand about the available options for obtaining details about fetal health and its genetic conditions. To talk more on the aspects of screening and options, we have Dr. Ashutosh Haldar, who will be sharing interesting insights on the importance of pregnancy and prenatal screenings for chromosomal and other genetic disorders. Dr. Haldar is a professor and head of Department of Reproductive Biology at AIIMS, New Delhi. His research interests are in reproductive endocrine disorders, infertility, malformation, disorder of sex development, recurrent pregnancy loss, etc. He's honored with various awards, like the recent one is Professor M.R. Mudgal Oration Awards 2021, Dr. Subhash Mukherjee Oration Award 2019. He's fellow of National Academy of Medical Sciences. He has received ICMR Senior Scientist Fellowship, Commonwealth Scholarship, Honor in Pathology, Silver Medal Foxy, AOGD, Birth Defects Congress, etc. He's expert member of various institutes and government organizations. He is reviewer and editor of many various journals. He has published over 94 research papers in various national and international medical journals. So with this, I would like to call upon Dr. Haldar to commence the talk. Dr. Haldar, please.
Thank you, Dr. Upadhyay. Good afternoon, everyone. And thanks, Premas Bhatek, for inviting me for this exercise. First of all, I'd like to say that I'm still not working actively on NIPS. But pre-NIPS development, I have some personal experience over 2 years. So I will touch upon those, my historical experiences. And also after rampant use of NIPS in Western world, the scenario which has changed from pre-NIPS to NIPS and what is going to be in future post-NIPS scenario. So briefly, I think it's a very limited number of slides, I think 21 slides, including last slides as a thanks. So it will be approximately half an hour.
Okay, sir.
So prenatal genetic screening at present. So at this moment, we have various options. One is prenatal genetic screening using ultrasonography in first trimester, mainly translucency, nuchal translucency, and this is only for chromosomal and some also other disorders. And best time to do this is 11 to 14 weeks of gestation and cutoff is 3.5 mm if it is a 11 weeks of gestation. But as such, its sensitivity is not very good. Prenatal genetic screening using level 2 ultrasonography we use routinely for malformation. This we usually advise at 10 to 12 weeks for major nuchal tube defect exclusion and again 16 to 20 weeks for major malformations. Again, if you suspect cardiac abnormality, then 20 to 24 weeks. And if you have a family with microcephaly usually can be picked up after 30 weeks. So we advise again that time. Then comes biochemical genetic screening, although this indications and utilization demand is decreasing. And this is for chromosomal as well as neural tube defect. It's the first trimester, we have two, free beta HCG and PAP-A. The dual marker sensitivity is not good, 55%. Second trimester, HCG, unconjugated histriol and alpha fetal protein, triple marker sensitivity around 65%. Or ACG, unconjugated histrion, inhibin A and alpha fetal protein, quad markers, sensitivity around 75%. And one can go for first trimester, followed by second trimester, you can combine, you can increase to up to 90%. Then recently the trend is for non-invasive prenatal screening, also known as NIPS or NIPT testing, using an NGS platform for chromosomal. Maternal peripheral venous blood cells free DNA after 10 weeks of pregnancy is a requirement. And at present, it's only few chromosomes, but work is going on for copy number variation, means microdeletion syndrome, and autosomal dominant disorder of paternal origin, those things, and RST typing. And NIPS or NIPT, the most important thing is a very high sensitivity and specificity. This is far better than any above things. So why prenatal screening? Chromosomal abnormalities are common and occur 1 in 250 births worldwide. Trisomy 21 is the commonest, and incidence is around 1 in 600 births worldwide. Trisomy 18 is the second most common autosomal trisomy, and incidence is around 1 in 2,500. The most common sex chromosomal aneuploidy is Klinefelter syndrome. Prevalence is 1 in 500 males or 1 in 1,000 births, and followed by monosomy X, the prevalence is around 1 in 1,700 females births. Although risk of aneuploidy increases with advancing maternal age, but most children with chromosome will be born to young mothers, as most births occur to young mothers, especially in India and third world countries. To avoid lifelong burden of chromosomal abnormality like trisomy 21 or sex chromosomal abnormality like Turner syndrome, for the family, healthcare professionals must provide some predictive and preventive measures. Maternal serum screening for aneuploidy has low sensitivity, thus leading to unnecessary invasive procedures with maternal and fetal risk. Then comes non-invasive prenatal screening. It's the most sensitive method at this moment. It's the first step to predict and thus reduce lifetime stress and expenses arising from birth of a child with chromosomal disorder. Prenatal screening for chromosomal and other abnormalities is not followed. Pregnancies in India leading to birth of chromosomal abnormalities in new causing challenges like economical, social, and emotional to the family as well as state, because for many genetic disorders, state supports. NIPS is the best, more than 99% sensitivity and specificity. So non-invasive screening method available along with ultrasound if we take, probably this may be one of the best options for a state government to decrease this load. Every patient should be informed in each pregnancy about the need and opportunity for this test for fetal chromosomal abnormalities. It is important that obstetrics professional be prepared to discuss benefits of the available screening test. Testing for chromosomal abnormalities should be an informed patient choice. Provision of adequate and accurate information, the patient's clinical context, accessible health care resources, values, interests, and goals, everything should be discussed with the patient. All patients should be offered a screening test, and all patients have the right to accept or decline the test after counseling. And in 2020, American College of Obstetrics and Gynecologists practice bulletin recommended that this cell-free DNA test and IPS test should be carried out to all pregnancy irrespective of the risk, and patients should be counseled for fetal chromosomal abnormalities. So then NIPS and NIPT history, before what, how it comes. If you see the history of for the development of NIPT or NIPS, first started in 1969 when Pragnoska found fetal cells in maternal blood. What he did, he karyotyped pregnant mother, mostly third trimester, few more than 14 weeks of gestation, but majority in third trimester pregnancy. Lymphocytes from the mother cultured, and they found in some cases XY karyotype, means female mother having male karyotype. So this is the first clue that fetal cells is available in pregnancy in pregnant mother. Then next development comes by Herzenberg in 1979. He used FACS to enrich fetal cells using antibody to HLA2 and in a HLA2 negative mothers carrying HLA2 positive fetus, and confirmed by identifying white chromatin containing cells using quinacrine staining. Quinacrine staining is a repeat heterochromatic area staining dye, fluorescent dye, and Y has a very big heterochromatin in QH region, and it fluoresces. One can detect easily that this is Y bearing cell. So then, if you see the prenatal diagnosis journal that started in 1981, and then even in first issue, they published this paper, detection of isolation of fetal cells from maternal blood using FACS. Then 1985 to 90, most work was on serum biomarker, AP as a marker of neural tube defect. Then 91 onwards, screening using ACG and alphabet protein for first trimester screening, and unconjugated estriol and AP for second trimester screening. Then 92 onwards, fetal cells in maternal blood, that work done in both USA and Europe, and USA continued with fetal cells in maternal blood, still they are working on that. And 94 onwards, Europe shifted from blood to fetal cells in maternal cervical or endocervical mucus or nevus. And in 94, I joined in European group, London group, UCL, for a project. My project was on blood. Non-invasive prenatal diagnosis using maternal blood in pregnancy. The project was submitted for Commonwealth Scholarship. It was accepted. And I worked in this project, not 6 months, because I delayed 2 months to go there. So 4 months I worked on. So what I did here, FACS shorter erythroblast was used to give in by hematologist using monoclonal antibody against transferrin and glycoporin A, many other, epsilon gamma also, fetal hemoglobin also, followed by culture of each erythroblast in each microwell plate at a time, 80-90 cells is cultured in that plate. And after 72 hours or like that, we took those one cell multiply, after division, it becomes around 15-20 cells, and put on multi-well slides at a time, 10 to 12 fish you can do. We did XY fish, and we found some of the clones XY positive. It's not a very high number. Out of 80, you may get 8 or 10 like that. And also those XY, maybe female fetus. So we did QF PCR for other polymorphic markers to find out whether, yes, non-maternal also peaks are there or not. So we found in some. As well as we tried to do nested PCR using Y sequence to amplify, and we found in some cases. Then we shifted to, and however, the concentration of cells and getting positive results, XY pregnancy with the XY erythroblast to get, is a very tedious job and very few. So we thought, let's think about non-invasive prenatal diagnosis in maternal cervical mucus or endocervical lavage. And I worked here for 2 years, 95 to 96. These are the various various equipment for this is a PPL, this is a endocervical cannula, this is a lavage equipment, various types of to collect cervical mucus. And this is the summary of the results. Results like if you see FISH positive, male fetal pregnancy, 21 out of 65, means 32% approximately. In female, yes, we got where we should not get Y plus, but we got Y plus. Concentration of cells varies between 0.05 to 13.5%. And here in female fetal pregnancy is 0.16%. Only one case was there, that's why 0.16%. This year we picked up 21 out of 61, just a little bit better, 34%. And we picked up much more here Y in female fetal pregnancy, 3 out of 56%. So FISH and PCR positive we found in male fetal pregnancy, 42% approximately, and false we got around 6%. And we later found that false Y amplification, that is, or FISH XY presence due to seminal cells. Here I can show you that this is a one of the pictures. This is a sperm. One can get even sperm by FISH in cervical mucus. This cells is a fetal origin because this is a trophoblastic cells. This is a maternal cells, which is much more dense. This is the more mitotic figure, so it's very loose, very big. And this is a sperm. You can see the shape. This is the head of the sperm. So after working more or less various years, although we have detected various chromosomal abnormalities, like see, this is a clamp from cervical mucus showing XY cell in a XY pregnancy. We detected XXY cell line, XYY cells. We found three copies and four copies of chromosome one, first one diploidy, this is a diploidy tetraploidy, because both three and four copies are there. So, and also we detected trisomy 18 as well as trisomy 21. And QFPCR, same thing. We did this is a XY amplification. This is a chromosome 18, chromosome 21 amplification in one go, multiplex PCR. This is chromosome 18, three copies. This is chromosome 18, four copies. So this probably tetraploidy. But because of cell concentration or the mixture, that's why some is different peaks. After this, we assessed various things, type of cervical mucus collection, mucus aspiration, suction, PPL, endocervical lavage. And we found in results in everywhere more or less similar. None is better than others. XY cells present in cervical mucus, that is definite. At least 1/3 cases we can detect. But we detected various chromosomal abnormality, but concentration are variable, 0.05 to 13-14%. So in this scenario, that time we never thought about screening. We thought only for diagnostics. So sperm contamination, something was another problem was that sperm contamination and seminal cells and sperms, that is a problem for PCR-based diagnosis, false positive even in female. And for FISH, it is not a problem because we can recognize the morphology, nuclear morphology of trophoblastic cells versus maternal olympocyte cells or seminal cells. So isolation of fetal cell clumps, we tried, is very tedious job and often wrong. And MAC, magnetic activated cell sorting using various antibodies, we tried. But we found that from mucus to isolate cells, dissociate cells, and enrich them, it's a very difficult process. We used N-acetylcysteine to dissolve the mucus, but if you go more treatment like a watery mucus, then it causes damage to the cell and fish results are very poor. So a lot of problems. In summary, fetal cells present in cervical mucus, there is no doubt about that. Feet detectable in 1/3 cases by fish and more, little more in with PCR method. For diagnosis, need enrichment of fetal cells by monoclonal antibodies and cell sorting or by isolating villous parts by micromanipulation. But technology that time was not sufficient to develop this as a reliable diagnostic techniques. So after this report, our group stopped working further on this method in cervical, using cervical mucus. So these are our publication. This is detection of fetal cells in transcervical sample and prenatal diagnosis of chromosomal abnormalities. Isolation of fetal cells, transcervical cell samples, this. Then prenatal detection of fetal aneuploid disease in transcervical cell samples. Then a minimally invasive prenatal diagnostic technique for collection of cervical cells. So this is cervical mucus. After 96, probably very few people worked on cervical mucus because that time we were looking for diagnostic, not screening. And technology was not good enough to do the job. Then regarding NIPS, how it develops. Lo et al. In 1997 first reported that cell-free DNA in maternal plasma early in pregnancy and led to the development of present practice of NIPT or NIPS. In 2008, two groups documented the massively parallel sequencing in cell-free DNA to detect aneuploidy, that is Thieu et al. And others. If you see various methods of NIPS, NGS based mostly, in USA, you will find that their sensitivity, specificity is little variable, like Verifee, Variant company. Their sensitivity for trisomy 21 is 99.9%, but for trisomy 13 is poor, 87.5%. And dropout, no report is 2.6%. And if you see the Panorama Natera best methods, you'll find all three chromosomes, 21, 18, and 13, 100% sensitivity and 100% specificity. But for call rate dropout is 5.4%, little higher. And cost-wise is in between. So it's a Panorama at this moment seems the best sensitivity and specificity, and very closely is the Verifee. And if you see as such sensitivity specificity of different methods, first chemistry screening around 80 to 90%, integrated screening around 90 to 94%, sequential screening 90 to 94%, quadruple screening around 80% alone, and NIPT is more than 99% for 21 and 81. And false positive rate is here much less than in serum screening where it's approximately 5%. So now pre-NIPS versus NIPS at present versus post-NIPS era. Pre-NIPS era, we used serum screening and ultrasound, risk cutoff group subjected for CVS and amniocentesis or amniocentesis, and followed by conventional cytogenetics or RACGH or a simple microarray leading to detection. So all chromosome aneuploidies we used to detect with this method, translocation also, and mosaicism also. If we use in conventional cytogenetics, we use microarray, then chromosomal aneuploidies, microdeletion, mosaicism, UPD, you can explain. And if we add ultrasound and AFV, so all fetal open defects almost we can explain. So, but this has a risk to the mother and fetus due to invasive procedures, 1-2% extra over background risk. NIPS era, plasma screening plus minus ultrasound. Here ultrasound is optional. Risk cutoff is divided and numbers reduced dramatically. This is very well accepted by the Western mothers. And after NIPS in use as a routine obstetrics practice, the number of CVS amniocentesis has reduced dramatically. Dramatical reduction of prenatal diagnostic procedures. So risk of fetus and mother due to invasive procedure is almost overcome. But this leads to increase in structural chromosomal abnormality, copy number variation, and also monogenic disorders. Because previously with CVS, we can detect structural abnormality, any unbalanced chromosomal problem we can detect by even microarray, copy number variation. And if we do such kind of invasive procedure, when counsel the couple, they if they have some monogenic disorder like thalassemia, hemophilia, whatever, or in, even in distant family, they opt for that test also. So we exclude common in that pedigree, that disorder also. So that advantage of doing those, detecting those things is lost. So what will be in the future? Post NIPS era, should we go back to pre-NIPS era or something new or improvement in present NIPS technology? Let's see. Present NIPS is not good enough for copy number variation, UPD, or monogenic disorders. So research is looking again for cell-based NIPS, NIPT, NIPD. Historically, in 2002, Bianchi et al., they worked very hard. Bianchi is from USA. She also came in several meetings during 94 to 96 when I was in UK. And she presented, as well as Simpson presented many data using erythroblast and peripheral blood. And they did non-invasive method of prenatal diagnosis using fetal nucleated blood cells in pregnant mother using FISH and later by PCR. Later, Clover Roy and from Denmark pursued rigorous effort to identify markers for fetal trophoblast, and they found antibodies to CD105 and max shorted, and they proved that yes, Y chromosome present in those trophoblasts. Later on, another group experiments concludes cell-based non-invasive testing is a meta-analysis. They conclude that it's not ready for clinical use, and this is still true today, although change may be imminent. And we need some kind of either NIPS improvement for including copy number variation and monogenic disorder, as well as cell-based diagnostics. This is similar to our conclusion in 1996 with cervical mucosal lavas. Same type of conclusion there. In 2012, successful cell-based NIPT for 63 fetuses at risk of cystic fibrosis or spinal muscular atrophy reported, but failed to convert to a reliable clinical test. There was no takers. And for last 10-12 years, Baylor College of Medicine working on cell-based NIPT, very vigorously. And purpose is that they want to do chromosome copy number variation and point mutation detected best chromosome analysis test in one go. And this recent they are reporting that in another few years probably they will be ready for use. So in conclusion, the advancement and opportunity to detect trisomy 21, 18, 13 and sex chromosomes with great accuracy by NIPS reduces invasive procedures remarkably, thus failing to detect structural abnormality, copy number variation and monogenic disorder in early pregnancy, leading to increase in birth of copy number variation, babies with copy number variation, means microdeletion syndrome, those kind of things, and monogenic disorders in babies. Cell-based NIPT is picking individual fetal cells and performing whole genome amplification followed by NGS microarray plus whole exome sequence, NGS and microarray to detect copy number variation, monogenic disorder, and chromosomal disorders. And this makes sense for reliability as a diagnostic method, not as a screening method. Because you are getting pure fetal cells, isolating almost pure fetal cells. Routine use of expanded carrier testing. If we add this with routine use of expanded carrier testing prior to conception, likely in the form of whole exome analysis and conventional cytogenetic analysis, could identify couples at risk for having a child with a deleterious single gene disorder or structural chromosomal disorder. So probably we need not only either diet improvement or cell-based NIPT or NIPS, plus we need preconception carrier testing so that we know what kind of monogenic disorders we should look for, give attention in that couple, as well as if they have a balanced translocation, which is asymptomatic, we can expect what kind of abnormality fetus may have. So particular, during analysis, particular translocation or abnormality can detect. So preconception genetic screening, this require is very simple. You need a three generation pedigree to find out whether any genetic disorders or abnormality or death or abortions in the family. Then do chromosomal analysis of the couple to exclude balanced translocation, which may be transmitted to the fetus. FMR1, this, if you take history for three generation, then FMR1 means mental retardation, Fragile X syndrome, you can guess somebody is suffering or not. And if you suspect, you can ask for this. Otherwise, baby will go on with the mental retardation, male baby. Then DNA microarray, array suggests SNP array. This copy number variation are common after NIPS as dramatic reduction prevents invasive diagnostic procedure after introduction of NIPS. NGS, whole exome for expanded carrier testing during analysis, local prevalence of the disease must be known, and that knowledge will help in data analysis and reporting. So this probably preconception genetic screening also required in near future, along with either NIPS, improved NIPS or cell-based NIPT. So this is the strategy. Preconception exome or genome sequencing, including copy number analysis. Copy number, if you get copy number variation abnormality or some recessive X-linked disorders or some dominant mutation, you can directly counsel the couple for pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. If they refuse, then either improved NIPT or cell-based NIPT, which is not yet available, maybe in future it will be coming, or prenatal diagnosis can be offered. And if nothing is found, then cell-based NIPT for de novo, CNB as well as point mutation, you need to exclude, because after NIPS, the number of these cases, CNV cases and point mutation cases increased. So I think I'll stop here. Thank you for inviting me. So thing is not very good at this moment for NIPS. You need to work very hard to improve it, to cover even monogenic disorder, copy number variation, or we have to switch off, switching to cell-based NIPS or NIPT, and along with preconception screening, genetic screening. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for providing us great insights regarding pre-pregnancy and prenatal screenings. I have a question here in chat box, if I can read that out for you. This is from Dr. Sirisha Vaidya. She's asking, can you please elaborate on post-NIPT era?
Post-NIPT era will be two things. One is cell-based NIPT and your pre-pregnancy genetic screening. These two has to be there. We are going to have these two because until unless NIPS is improved, its technology to expand its detection limit, not only for three chromosomes, all CNVs, and also if required monogenic disorder. Otherwise, one, because what happens is used almost in all pregnancy in Western countries. And they found that chromosomal these three has reduced lot, but because of no indication for invasive testing, number of copy number variation, maybe some inherited, some maybe mostly de novo, those are increasing. So previously in pre-NIPT era, we used to do chromosomal analysis and targeted families monogenic disorder also. So we prevented some of the most of those. Now most of the pregnancies do not require any invasive procedure. So those advantages of conventional or RSGH is lost. So this we have to means expand NIPS detectability to this, then only it can compete with cell-based NIPT. And pre-pregnancy screening, genetic screening is must because this will give you in that couple what kind of monogenic disorder or copy number variation is expected. DiGeorge syndrome, 22q deletion syndrome, very often the carriers may be mother or father.
Yeah. So related with that, I mean, I have one question. You know, one of the important steps, I think, for wider adoption of these screenings are, I think, awareness around the screening test and also the affordability. So in that regard, what could be the government's role to increase the accessibility of these prenatal tests? I mean, I know I'm looking at the India's population and most of the mother who are into interiors, there is not much accessibility, and also I think awareness is also important factor. So what do you think like government role should be in this case?
My opinion in this regards that government should invest for prediction and prevention rather than curative medicine. This is actually economically as well as stress factor, social stress, correct, stigma, money, for both for government as well as for, see, all government hospitals expense is very expensive. If trisomy 21 or trisomy 18 remains in ICU for 1 month, how much money government invests for that? So this is very important for prediction prevention government to invest here rather than later on. So this will be a win-win situation for both for patient as well as government, economically and stress situations. Government should take over this.
Yes, correct. So in that regard, I mean, since there are so many other traditional methods of detecting, doing prenatal screening, now NIPT and NIPS era has begun. So What do you see the future of NIPT, especially when, you know, as you mentioned also in your one of those slides that ACOG issued a guideline that NIPT should be given to all patients, regardless of maternal age or baseline risk.
Yes.
So what is its future right in India? Like it's going really the way it should?
See, NIPS, I think still not optimal. You need more things. NIPS, see, if your sensitivity and specificity is 100%, then why you give a risk factor? You must report as a yes or no. But you are giving a risk factor means you are also not sure. Risk may be 1 in 1,000, risk may be 1 in 100, risk may be 1 in 10,000. So that way you are reporting. That is actually nonsense to me. It's like your serum screening. You have to give, if your technology, you rely on your technology is such a good, accurate, 100% sensitivity, 100% specificity, positive predictive value is very high, over 90%. Then why not you refine a little bit more in your bioinformatics and give yes or no? And if you can give yes or no, then it is not a NIPS, then it will be NIPD. NIPD, non-invasive prenatal diagnosis, that is we want. That will give very clear-cut message to the gynecologist and treating clinicians. The counseling will be very easy. Couple also will be very clear. Hey, or not. Yes or no. If it is a yes, then if it is 100% sensitivity, then why in the reciprocity? But yes, I told you that only 3 chromosomes is not good enough. You need to cover copy number variation and monogenic disorder also. Then only it will be perfect. Otherwise, cell-based NIPT going to come and take your market from you to another level.
So related with that, I have one more question before I actually get into, I have seen a couple of questions in the chat box. So for that, now that you also mentioned that there are a lot of, prenatal screening is around chromosome 21, 18, 13 or sex chromosome. So do you anticipate that rare autosomal trisomies will also be concerned later on?
See, pure other autosomal trisomy can be at birth, but they are usually do not survive long.
Okay.
If it is a pure form, but if it is a mosaic form, then that can lead to a lot of wastage of money and anxiety, stress of the family. And most of those are mosaic and they can survive several years. So this, you have to cover those things. Mosaicism also another factors. And copy number variation, that also, mostly they are not lethal, but they produce lifelong burden to the family. So you have to take care of those. And your technology will be benefited with prenatal genetic screening. Not prenatal, pre-pregnancy genetic screening.
Okay.
You know that this couple has this kind of problem likely to be. So your analysis will target those also in a better way.
Okay. So expanded NIPT is something which is going to be... other requirement, I mean, along with what we have right now in NIPT, along with all those CNB and
mosaicism. Expanded, I will say you have to improve your technology.
Okay.
See, you are doing everything, but analysis portion only restricting 3-5 chromosomes. So your analysis, bioinformatics, should be much better, but I know the limitation of cell-free DNA. It's a very little amount, mostly maternal. And from there, I'm finger crossed, I should not say like that. In actually mucus, now I find that if I had knowledge this much that time, I could have been continued with cervical mucus, because there in some cases, in most of the cases, more than 1% cells foetal origin, more than in majority cases.
Mm-hmm.
It's a quite a high amount of foetal cells in cervical mucus. But that time we did not have technique, and I did not have that thinking. And we had a meeting with Charles Rodek, Jai Delanti, Joyce Harper, PGD, mother of PGD, mm-hmm. and Adinolfi, and we decided that we are not spend any further pound for this project, and we returned 65,000 pound to the birth defect center. And I returned to India.
Mm-hmm.
So, but now I find that this is a much better working material than maternal blood cells or fetal cells. Because in maternal blood, fetal cells is very few, very few. Troglodytic cells, hardly any. Erythroblast, little bit. That is also somebody, I think, counted as 1 to 3 per 1 ml blood.
Mm-hmm.
So, and here is a 1% in majority cases, and in some cases as high as 13% cells. Mm-hmm. So, but probably I think if that cell-based therapy, whichever Bellar College of Medicine is trying, it failed, I think the group need to work again from this, because we have now whole genome amplification system, then NGS system, then so many better technologies, so that we can develop. I think if I was young, like 30 years before, it could have been started again.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. So I see one more question. I think partly you have already answered it, but again, this is Namrata Alonde. She's asking, what is your opinion for NIPS for all chromosomes would be preferred rather than five common markers with microdeletions?
To me, it should be all chromosomes,
mm-hmm.
all copy number variations, and also should be capable of detecting mosaicism. So probably NIPT versus cell-based NIPT, I will prefer cell-based NIPTs.
Mm-hmm.
Future prospect is better.
Okay.
If it comes.
Okay. So with that.
I guess Dr. Ankita Trivedi, she wants to ask. Dr. Ankita, I'm allowing you to talk. Please unmute yourself and you can ask your question. Dr. Ankita?
So not unmuted.
Yeah. Dr. Ankita, you can unmute yourself. Okay, then there is one more participants. Anuja, can you unmute yourself and ask your question if you have any?
Is there any problem?
I think no.
We are not unmuting.
Okay. So
they're still on mute. So Divya, do you see any more questions in the Q&A or in chat box?
Yes. There are one question from Madhu. And she's asking, can NIPT be of any help in case of twins or triplets?
I think you can answer better. But I think already NIPS or NIPT is used for twins.
Twin pregnancy, yes.
It's possible. Even I think for surrogate donor oocytes also they are working. It's coming up. And I think Natera platform will be better. They use SNP based things. That will be more accurate.
Yeah. Okay. So I don't think any more questions here. So with that, Divya, anything else to add?
No, I can. I think we can wrap up.
Okay, great. So thank you, Dr. Halda, for giving such an insightful talk. And thanks a lot for attendees who have been part of this webinar. And we will see you again in future with any such topic later on, which is mostly oriented towards all these latest technology, what is there, and other government initiative, what we are observing here in India. So thanks again, Dr. Halda.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Dr. Halda. Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.